My name is Max Zurcher. I live in Minot, North Dakota. I was in Vietnam. I got there the 14th of... Gee, that's dumb. I just completely went out of my mind. Well, 14th of May,
okay.
1966.
Why don't you tell me that you got to Vietnam in 1966? Just to put that in a statement for me.
I got to Vietnam in 1966.
And what service were you in and what was your rank?
I was Army Corporal.
And what were you trained to be?
Infantry.
So as an infantryman, I could read off your shirt. Mm-hmm. Where were you in Vietnam and what were you doing?
We were at Ben Phuc, that's 60 miles south of Saigon. And I was in infantry. We had our base camp there, Ben Phuc. We were near the village at the time. And we were in the Delta, which is all rice paddies in the Mekong Delta. And our area of operation was in that area. It was a search and destroy area. And it was a lot of Vietnam was you couldn't shoot till you were shot at. And this was a free fire zone, so we could shoot at anybody in this area. And we would go out on patrols during the day, leave ambush patrols for the night or for the day. And a lot of the ambush patrols would get hit. And then we were with a mechanized unit called Armored Personnel Carriers, M113s.
Okay, tell me, start with the mechanized unit again.
Okay, we were a mechanized unit, Armored Personnel Carriers, M113s, and they were a track vehicle that we didn't use a lot during the raining season because they, for obvious reasons, we couldn't get through the rice paddies. And when we did go through the rice paddies, we destroyed a lot of the rice. And one of the things we noticed when we come back out again, it was all replanted. So they were very industrial people over there. And I feel kind of guilty about what we did, even though I feel my service is, you know, I'm very proud of my service.
So tell me what you feel guilty about then.
Well, I'm a farmer, and these people were farmers. And I've seen what we did destroying their crops and how industrious they was to be out there. And they always took a shot at us, you know, at our track. So we knew they didn't appreciate what we were doing to their crops. And that's the part I felt most guilty about.
But they weren't necessarily destroying the crops on purpose, were you? Was it just?
Well, no, it was just we couldn't. That's the only, there's the only roads we had was through the rice paddies. Everything was dikes over there. So it was a situation where, you know, it was intolerable to them, but I mean, we had to do it. But most of the time, when we had rainy periods or the monsoon rain, we took helicopters, the Huey 1H, and we'd fly the whole company out, or a platoon, we'd be going out on a mission to try to find where the Viet Cong were hidden. And a lot of them, of course, were back in the villages that were evacuated. And that's where we had a lot of contacts, was in the villages and their rice paddies.
So you'd be dropped in an area. Did you have any more specific information than just you're going to get dropped in an area and you have to secure it?
Well, I was battalion radio operator, and one of my jobs was to take my company commander to battalion headquarters every night, which was on the south side of the village. We were on the north side, and the Vietnamese RVNs wanted us to have a battalion headquarters on the other end of the village for some odd reason. And we go over there, and then we get the orders for the next day. And me and I was at that time 24 years old. I was a little more educated, so I'd back my Jeep up to the battalion headquarters, and I could see what they were doing. They were shoving little men around, you know, and I knew what that meant. I'd seen it before. And that's kind of unique in a way, because nobody else thought of doing something like that, because the only window they had was on the east side, and we'd go there. We'd go there, curfew was 8 o'clock, so we always, in the village, we always went after 8 o'clock. And I'd have my M16 out one side and the company commander, his on the other side, and we'd drive 60 miles through town, 60 miles an hour. And it was scary, of course, because we got, not every night, but I'd say at least once a week or twice a week, we get mortared, and the mortars come out of the village, because there was a river through the village, and the Viet Cong would use the boats, use boats all the time. They'd fire 5-6 mortar rounds, and then by the time we get out there, they were gone. They were up the creek, you might say. So
it must have been very difficult when you were back at the base. I mean, how much rest would you get?
Very little, especially when I first got to Vietnam. I went to MACV headquarters as a security guard. That's where General Westmoreland was at the time. He was there until 68. And we were supplemented the police, the MPs there. And our duty was around the fence at night, stationed around the fence. And then we, odd as it might sound, we had garbage detail. They had to have armed guards for take the garbage out from the headquarters. And they had helicopters. We were there for 2 weeks, so once a week we'd have to fly as M60 machine gunners on a helicopter. And the second time I was out, we got shot down. And of course, the only place to land was on either the steel pads or cement. And of course, the two pilots said we were shot down. And being a farmer, I was looking around a little bit, and it looked more like it was an oil leak. But the next time I talked to anybody that was out, they said both the pilot and co-pilot got silver stars, so it must have been real. So made us a little mad, but but that's part of war, I guess.
Now, you were in very dangerous situations. Did you ever get wounded?
4 times.
Could you tell me you got wounded 4 times?
Yeah, I got wounded 4 times. The first time we were coming off, like I mentioned earlier, we were on patrol every day. I went on an ambush patrol at night 19 days in a row. And I think it was the 20th of June, 67, we were coming back in, and the guy behind me, we had two radio operators, and one was behind the squad leader, and I was second from the end. And the guy behind me, I won't mention his name, but I could see him nodding off, and he had an M60 machine gun. And next thing I knew, 10 rounds come out, and of course went through the bathroom, my radio, one between my arm and my side. I had a big gash in my side and burn on my arm. And of course we all hit the dirt, and we're scared. We didn't know what was coming on. We were right near a bridge, which all the bridges are guarded by Arvin soldiers, and they opened up on us. And every time the squad leader would raise his hand to say GIs, they'd open up on us. So we finally, and the guy with the other radio was so scared, he didn't know what to do, you know, and they couldn't call anybody. And finally got a hold of somebody, got him to stop firing it. And then the second time I got hurt, I fell in a punji pit. And the third time,
tell us what that is.
Oh, a punji pit is where the dikes are. They have a hole that's dug in there, and then they put enough dirt on so the vegetation will grow to cover it up. And then there's punji sticks in there. And I would say 40, 50 punji sticks in a hole. And they're maybe half inch thick, and then sharpened to a point, and then rubbed in body excrement. And a lot of the guys that got hurt, they got infection. And of course, if it was near a bone and you got infection in the bone, you'd be in the hospital 4 or 5 months, or even some of them died. Fortunately, the one I fell in, a rat was in it and chewed a lot of the punch, the tops off. So all I got was, you know, from my boot up, I got a big scar on my left leg. And I was more scared of the rat than falling in the hole. The rats are about 3 feet long over there. And that scared the devil out of me. And shortly after that, our platoon got behind the rest of the company, and they were way up in a tree line. And I could see them moving through the tree line, and I see this Viet Cong come running out, running down a dike. And I had my gun on him all the time, looking to see if he had a gun. And he didn't. And then he turned to go north, and I could have shot him in the back. Well, I consider myself a Christian, so I couldn't do that. And then that happened once after that again with a different commander. I caught hell both times, but I feel I'd done the right thing, even though I'm having dreams about it now, that did I do the right thing, you know, but I feel I did. So,
and then you said a fourth time.
Yeah, that's the $1 million wound. That's when I got to go home, kind of, basically. I was in the 23rd evac first I went to a MASH unit in the field, so it was a 10. Then we went to the 23rd evac hospital in Saigon for 3 weeks, a month in Japan, 2 months in Fitzsimmons in Denver. And then our job was to feed the soldiers that had lost legs, arms, lost their vision. And I had to do that in Japan for a whole month. And I was so happy when we were going home for Christmas. It happened to be the 23rd of December. And
so you mentioned this $1 million wound. What was that wound?
Well, I got shot in the arm. And a bullet went through my side, blew a big hole in my side, came out the back. And we were in water about up to our waist, called the Plain of Reeds. And I had my arm down, trying to hold my head up out of the water to keep from drowning. And it was in the mud, and my hand was sinking in. I tried hollering, and my mouth was open, but nothing was coming out. But we were constantly being fired back and forth. It was fire-based cudgel, was what it was called. And finally, some words come out, and Sergeant got to come to me, and then he called for the medic. And the medic come, and he apparently only had 28 wound pouches. He stuck them all in my side, called the company commander, and he says, "I don't think Big Max is going to make it." So I'd been his battalion RTO. I'd just become a common sergeant at that time. And I didn't know much after that until I got in the hospital in Saigon. But
so they must have taken you out in a helicopter, I guess.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, shooting all the time, you know. And I was the only one on the helicopter. They threw me on the floor. Well, I thought I was the only one. I couldn't see anybody. And then I seen two legs, because I was laying on the floor. I seen two legs. And I looked over, there was a bullet hole right between his feet. And right up through the roof of the helicopter, I could see the hole. And the guy that was sitting there was completely white. He was so scared. But he could have been combat fatigue. He could have been put on, because he was stripped down of all his gear. So we had that happen before, you know. We got in heavy battle that we lost, people to various things, that being scared, I guess you'd say, most of all.
I've got a couple of questions. First of all, being a radio operator, did you figure you were a target? An extra, more of a target?
Well, yeah. We've written two books, and one of them is Warrior Words 2014 and Warrior Words 2015, and I have my story in the Warrior Words 2014. And I write about the guys making fun of me, being I was 6'3" and had a 6-foot antenna on my radio. So I'm the biggest target out there. That's, you know, there was, you had to have humor or you would have died of not having any contact with anybody, because everybody, you know, had humor. So hard to believe in combat conditions, but when we were back in base camp, we I have one of the things in the story is when we were back and we were sitting in our underwear drinking warm Black Label beer, because that's all the beer we had was Black Label and it was always warm. So that was a humorous thing too. You'd see us sitting there with our thongs on and shorts, you know, it kind of relieved a lot of the tension.
But you must have seen, lost a lot of friends.
Yeah, I, 22. Yeah, and we had a real bad thing happen. I got there the 5th of June, the 25th of June. I come in the morning from ambush patrol, and they were just leaving. The M113s were leaving the APCs to go out on a mission and leave us stay behind ambush patrol. And our platoon sergeant was our first lieutenant, our platoon leader was killed already, Lieutenant Barry. And our platoon leader, Sergeant Quingus, says to my squad leader to leave Max sleep because he's going out again tonight on ambush patrol. And when they went out on this mission, we go up, being that we're in the rice paddies, we have to go across all these big, huge dikes. The rice paddies are small dikes, and they pump that water in with a paddle wheel with the feet, walking. That's how they pump the water from one rice paddy to the other. But these canals are, you know, anywhere 10, 12 feet high that are full of water, bringing the water in. And they had, our company commander says, leave the bridging in. We had to bridge it. We carried the bridging on the side of the APC. And the company commander says, leave the bridging in for quick reaction. Well, I'm, you know, like I said, they use the canoes and boats and stuff to go up the canal. And they come up and they had got a hold of a 250-pound dud bomb from one of the plane strikes. And they tied that on the bridging, and when Johnny went out, our platoon leader, 5 were killed, 2 were seriously wounded, and I got up shortly before they were called out, was taking a shower. So I was taking a shower, I come back to the mess hall to eat, none of my platoon were there, and we had all officers are in that same area where we were eating, and we could hear come over the loudspeaker that there was a bad accident and 5 were killed, 2 seriously wounded. And in my story, I write about that I laid in bed that night crying, looking at 6 empty cots. And that's the last time I cried until 2003 when my brother died. I had no emotion. No motion for a funeral or anybody dying or being sick. That's what Vietnam did to any of us.
What was the weather like when you were over there?
Humid, very humid, always over 100 degrees. At night it would get cold, you'd freeze. We'd be in the same clothes we went out with, and we'd be laying out there shivering all night, and I don't know how we slept, but. And then that's another bad thing with these ambush patrols at night, because as we lost people, we got down to 5-6 people, and they tried to keep 2 people awake at night. Well, I woke up one night and nobody was awake. And this was shortly after I got there, and from then on I never slept at night. So I made sure that we were safe. Somebody had to. And then we had a starlight scope, so we could see. We could hear the enemy coming. They'd chant, "GI, we get you tonight," stuff like that, but in English. very broken English, but English. And you're pretty scared.
What do you think about the geography? What did the country look like to you?
Beautiful, beautiful country. That's one of the things that I'm kind of ashamed of, that we were destroying that beauty. And so many of our guys have gone back. And there's a battalion RTO and a radio company. And our company was Metzler. He went back in 94 and 95. And he said, it's unbelievable how beautiful it was when it's not being destroyed. And then he went back to our base camp. And the east end of our base camp, the artillery was there too, in with us in the base camp. The east end of the base camp was a peanut factory, and the west end was tennis courts. So it was an amazing transition, you know.
Do you think you could ever go back?
I've wanted to go back, but I had a heart transplant 13 years ago, and that's one of the reasons why I'm taking so much medication. And when this wound was my last wound, we have reunions now since 2001. So I've made acquaintance with a medic and several of the guys I was with in the platoon. And the medic happened to be Doc Randall was his name. He was born here in Minot. Otherwise, we go to reunions and we put pins in where we're from. There's one pin in North Dakota, and that's me. And but Doc had said that he could see my heart beating through the hole, so that's why he thought I was maybe bleeding, you know, internally. And I fooled him. I made it.
Now, have you had any effects that you know from Agent Orange?
Well, yeah, ischemic heart disease, I had that. That's why I had the heart transplant 13 years ago. I have neuropathy, which is one of the things that very prevalent. I don't have sugar diabetes, which is a normal cause of neuropathy. And many people are experiencing it now. And when you put in for disability, you have to put in for within 1 year of leaving Vietnam for neuropathy. Well, it's 50 some years later and you still have to put in 1 year before you get back from Vietnam. So that's kind of a comical thing too.
What was your treatment like when you got back from Vietnam, back over to the States here?
Well, I that was a wonderful thing about being coming through the hospital system back, because I didn't experience what so many of the larger cities was the main thing. I hear this story from everybody that I'm with at when we have our reunions, and I'm like I said, I'm the only pin in North Dakota, and so you know a lot of them come from big cities that never fired a rifle before, and a lot of Southern people that were less educated, so that was hard on them. But I don't know. My biggest regret, like I said, was that I have not gone back when I should have, you know, when Metz was there in 94, 95. Now, with all this medication, I can't. And my neuropathy is so bad, I can hardly walk. So, but I'm in a PTSD group, been in group since 1979. That's when it started in Minot. Excuse me, 83, 79 is when it started. And I'm still in it today. In fact, yesterday was our meeting, once a week.
So do you talk about experiences at these meetings?
Well, we've been together for so long that sometimes, unless somebody, in fact, yesterday what happened, I spoke about reoccurring dreams. And one of the things that was so odd, because we talked about that already, was that I had let two guys get away because they were not armed, and I didn't want to shoot them in the back. And these dreams, a lot of times, I don't have to be asleep. I can just close my eyes during the day, and I start dreaming and wondering, did I do the right thing? Did I do the right thing, you know, because I'd caught hell from the company commanders. Then they called in artillery because we couldn't see, you know, they were in the air, or they could see there was more people, or more Viet Cong or North Vietnamese than what we could see. And they would come in with this artillery and pretty much obliterate the area that they were firing in. I'm sure it's grown over now. When we flew in the helicopters, I took a lot of pictures of the bombs, the bomb craters and stuff like that. And a lot of, I won't mention some of the stuff, but things that I, you know, wanted to remember, I guess, in a way, and have people back here that wouldn't believe what war is, to show them. And mysteriously, when I was wounded, eventually my footlocker caught up with me, minus 200 and some photos and $300. And any of my, I kept a lot of stuff. We found punji sticks, when the planes would come over supporting us, I kept some of the shells, 20 millimeter shells. I had quite a collection, but unfortunately that was gone. And that was one of the odd things about being in a war zone. I don't know if it's particular to Vietnam, but any letters that we were sent from home, we had to burn afterwards, so that if their village was ever overrun, they would not have the addresses of our parents or whoever had been writing to us. So. But I have my mother's letters from me, I've written several stories, and I keep going to the reunions and telling the other guys, I says, you've got to write this stuff down. And then I would say, do you remember? And there were six guys sitting there, no, 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 no. And it's hard to have a conversation about. So we talk about what happened yesterday or week before.
I've seen people that have written letters back here. I've seen, you know, those letters. And it seems like in most of them, I don't know if you did the same thing, most of them started out with, well, everything's fine, and yesterday was this, and then all of a sudden in the middle, there's like a paragraph that is sort of expressing how difficult it was, and then you go back out. Did you write letters like that?
Well, I wrote letters that I shouldn't have wrote. I know that for a fact. I wrote about, you know, my squad was all wiped out. And I wrote that home, excuse me. And one of the funny things is when the two guys that were wounded come back in 2 months into our company, one was made a cook, one was made a security guard. And I knew I had wrote that letter home and never did find that letter. Well, here 3 years ago in January, my sister gave me 6 or 7 letters that she had kept from my mother. And one thing that happened, I helped build the chapel over there called the Chapel of Cyrenian. A lot of people don't know what that means, but Joseph from Cyrenia was the one that took the cross from Jesus and carried the cross. So it was named the Chapel of Cyrenia. And the cross is crooked. And when we put the cross up, we put it straight up. And our chaplain, Tom Norton, come and he says, what are you guys doing? Well, we had no idea that the cross was the cross of Jesus. And when Bob and Ricky come home, Bob was a cook, and he come back to me, and I was in headquarters at that time in a different hooch. And he come to me and he says, Max, I have not been baptized. So I says, well, I knew the chaplain very well, so I went and talked to the chaplain, Tom Norton, told him that Bob had not been baptized. baptized. So he says, well, let's do it next Sunday if you're not out on a patrol. So that next Sunday, I was there with Bob, and Bob was baptized a Christian warrior, and I was his godfather. And I keep reminding of that, even though he's a month older than I am. Every time I talk to him, I remind him that I'm his godfather. So.
Religion seems very important to you. Did it help you when you were over there?
Well, I don't think I'd have made it without it.
I need you to tell me, I don't think you would have made it without your sense of religion, if you could put that in a statement.
Well, I strongly feel that the people that were had a mission in life as a Christian really, really helped. And you could hear people that were dying, that were praying, you know, and calling for their mother. That was pretty much standard. When somebody was dying, they'd call for their mother. We heard that a lot. And every war is different, but it affects the people the same way. It's like we use PTSD now. Well, I use post-traumatic stress. I dropped the D because people don't understand what the D was. And now the VA is doing that too. A lot of people that have taken their lives is because they can't relate to what they did or what happened to them in the war zone, the Gulf War, the Iraq War, the Afghan War. We've lost a lot of people, you know, and that as a Christian makes me feel bad that these individuals had to go through all this.
Now, Max, when you were wounded, the severe wounding, or even some of the other ones, did you find yourself praying after that happened?
Oh, yeah. Well, one of the experiences that I don't know if a lot of people understand or believe me, but when I was laying there in that water up to my, well, almost drowning, I looked up and I seen my whole family, my sister all the way up to my oldest, the youngest sister, the oldest sister, my parents, my grandparents, all that flashed. You could see them pictures just like they were real pictures in the sky. So that makes me a stronger believer, I think, than a lot of people might understand. And a lot of people experience things like that. So
I didn't ask you, were you drafted or did you enlist?
I was drafted. That's why I was 23 when I went in. When I got to Vietnam, I was 24. And that helped me. I think I didn't take chances like some of the younger troops. I'm not afraid to admit that I hid once in a while, a little bit, you know. I'd hide behind one of the APCs when the farmers were shooting at us. Maybe a natural thing, but I didn't want to make myself too big a target. And,
we were big enough as a
well, yeah, and then we were sitting on the track besides. So, and a lot of these things happened that were happening for the first time. So, I mean, it was a scary experience. After we got used to it, we didn't really, half the time they did bullets didn't get halfway out to us. You know, their guns are 150 years old, I suppose. And, there were so many good things that happened, and now that we've gotten together with both my company commanders, and we made videos of a lot of our first reunions, in 2002, my second company commander, who I was battalion radio operator for, was in Charlotte, South Carolina. And it so happens he was trying to think now, what is this, from 9/11, what do they call them? Every state has one. Goodness sakes. But anyway, he was in charge of the, of, well, it don't help
Homeland
much.
Security.
Homeland Security. Yeah, he was appointed by Governor Ridge, who was the, in the White House, to be head of that department in South Carolina. And he come there, and he was our guest speaker. And when he spoke a lot, started with the Minuteman and went all the way through to the wars. We were, the 9th Division was put together in 66 at Fort Riley, Kansas. So it was new when they got there in December. It was a, they had been active during World War II. And, but there's so many things, excuse me, unique what happened to us, because one of the last times I went over to battalion headquarters, took the company commander over there, and I'd backed my Jeep up, and of course, we didn't wear a rank. And I had this young gentleman come out, second lieutenant, and asked me, he says, sir, come on in, we're about ready to start. And I kind of had to look down and say, I'm a PFC. Private first class. And he introduced himself, and he says, I'm Tom Franks. And I went, Max Zurcher, which didn't mean nothing to either one of us at the time. But Tommy Franks was a four-star general, and he was Central Command general during the Gulf War in Iraq and Afghanistan. And we had, out of our battalion, which was there for 3.5 years. We had 1 4-star, 1 3-star, and 5 2-star generals come out of our battalion. And two of them were there, of course, when I was there. Our battalion, a commander, and my company commander were both, our both major generals retired. And, but when Captain Siegfried spoke at our reunion in 2002, and he got towards the end, and he says I really, really enjoyed being with this group because they were such a wonderful group of men. And he says, I've got to thank Max, Lee, Metz. He pointed us three guys out, and I was the first name mentioned, and of course, Metz didn't particularly care for that. But I, it kind of made a tear come to my eye that he thought that much of me, you know. But that's how cohesive the war is. I mean, the troops have to be, you have to be close. You have to love one another, you know, to, because they're protecting you and you're protecting them. So I feel that's a wonderful thing, you know, that people can be that close, you know, and then you go home. A lot of times, like the five guys that were killed in the APC that day when they were at 250-pound bomb blew up, they're gone. I never seen them men again. And in 2014, Johnny Quinga was our platoon leader. In 2014, we got his wife and one of his two boys that both spent 20 years in the service in honor of their dad and their mother, Rose, come to our reunion. And we have a picture of that, which is something that I look at a lot. In fact, I look at all my pictures, you know, from time to time because of our reunions. And then, this Metzler that I mentioned, our company, RTO, we that's the gentleman that was back in 94 and 95 to Vietnam alone. And we called each other quite a bit. And one of the things that he always mentions is that, you know, how strongly he felt about the people that he served with. And you know, I take that means me too.